apartment with four kids, and of course our four kids had lots of friends, so it was rare that our house had less than a dozen kids in it at any given time. And sometimes we'd have a dozen kids and none of them were ours, so it's just a... And so we kind of decided, you know what, there's just not a lot of point in putting a lot of money into the house because it's just going to kind of get wrecked. We'd rather have the house be fun for the kids to play in than be all super nice and be on them all the time. But then we decided, well, now that they're out of the house, or pretty much mostly out of the house, we figured, ha-ha, now's the time. We're going to remodel our upstairs. We have three bedrooms up there, a bathroom, and a long hallway, and we're going to redo it all. And we started with great enthusiasm. One bedroom done. The next bedroom done. The hallway done. The bathroom done. And then I got tired. And then the holidays came. And so we took a break. And I liked the break. I just couldn't get back to doing it. And now I'm trying everything I can do to muster up the energy to finish off that last bedroom, which is actually ours. And my amazing, wonderful, patient wife is praying fervently for energy to come upon me again. You ever notice, like, if you've gotten out of the habit of exercising, for those who exercise, how hard it is to get back in? Or how many know that when you go to the gym on January 2nd, the busiest day of the year at the gym, and as the year goes on, the attendance drops off? How many know this is true in church life? Anybody who's involved in leadership or pastoring a church knows it is so much easier to generate the enthusiasm to start something than to sustain the enthusiasm to finish something. Amen. You know, the Bible places a very, very high value on finishing. Amen. The book of Ecclesiastes says this: the end of a matter is better than its beginning. Amen. Which basically means it's better to finish something than to just start something. Now, what's the greatest thing in the universe? I think I heard someone say it. Coffee? Yep, that would be, that's definitely in the top three. The word I was thinking of was love. Love. Now, I want to read a scripture from the Gospel of John, and this is actually the night before Jesus is crucified. It's his last night, so to speak, and he's having a meal. He's actually celebrating the Passover meal with his disciples. And it's recorded, says this, says, now before the feast of the Passover, Jesus, knowing that his hour had come, that he would depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world. I love this phrase. He loved them to the end. Amen. He loved them to the end. And Jesus actually warned that the greatest challenge in these last days, how many know we're in the last days? Right? We're in the last days. We've been in the last days for a little bit of time. Jesus came to kind of kick off the last days. And so we're kind of in those. The next major, if you will, the next real major event in God's timing really is the reappearing of Jesus. Okay, and I don't know when that'll be, but we're in those last days. And he said that the greatest challenge in these last days before his reappearing would be that the love of many would grow cold. What a really sober warning. And we might be tempted, like Peter, to say, well, that might happen to others, but not me, Lord. I'm the special exception. Not to burst your bubble. Anyways, Jesus said, because lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold. But the one who endures to the end, he will be saved. All right? And so I want to start a new series. I want to call it Love to the End. All right, I want to talk about healthy relationships, what it means to have healthy relationships, what it means to love, what it looks like for a healthy church to have healthy relationships. And it's this love of God which is unquenchable. The Bible describes the love of God as unquenchable. It's like the thing that sustains the entire universe. I was thinking this morning, I was thinking about this idea that God's love is described as an unquenchable fire. And I was thinking about, you know, this morning, even our own solar system is basically sustained by the sun, the heat and the energy from the sun. That thing is so powerfully heated, so to speak. It's got so much energy. We're 93 million miles away from it, and its energy heats and sustains. If you get even within 3 million miles of the sun, you will burn up. The temperature is still like 300 degrees or something. 3 million miles away. And astronomers estimate, for those who care about these things, that the sun's been burning for almost 5 billion years, and it's only halfway through its energy. It's got 5 billion more years to go burning at that rate. But it is burning out, and it's fading. The love of God is unfading. Amen. Will never run out. It's been energizing, if you will, heaven and all of creation since time began and will for all eternity. Here's how Song of Song describes, says this, how this unquenchable love that characterizes the kingdom of heaven. It says, "Fasten me upon your heart as a seal of fire forevermore. This living, consuming flame will seal you as my prisoner of love. My passion is stronger than the chains of death and the grave. All consuming as the very flashes of fire from the burning heart of God. Place this fierce, unrelenting fire over your entire being. Rivers of pain and persecution will never extinguish this flame." We see that played out when Jesus is on the cross. The very one who all things were created through and for, and the one who came to his own and they did not recognize him, and they crucified him, and then they mocked him. As they're crucifying him, his very creation mocking him, he looks down and he says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Endless floods will be unable to quench this raging fire that burns within you. Everything will be consumed. It will stop as nothing as you yield everything to this furious fire until it won't even seem to you like a sacrifice anymore. How many would like that kind of love? That unquenchable fire within you, within your own heart, that nothing could dampen it. I mean, think about, let's be honest, think of how easily we get offended. Come on, it's not just me. I'm sometimes stunned at my own offensiveness, like, really? Like, that bothered me. Imagine having a kind of love that there is absolutely nothing, no level of rejection, no level of persecution even, no level of hatred could cause it to dampen even one bit. And that last phrase, it says, it will stop at nothing as you yield everything to this furious fire until it won't even seem to you like a sacrifice anymore. Could you imagine being filled with a love, having such an intensity of love that the sacrifice that love oftentimes require wouldn't even feel like a sacrifice? During Easter, we looked at a story that occurred shortly after Jesus' resurrection. It was a story where two disciples were walking on the road to Emmaus, which is a town outside of Jerusalem, and Jesus met them on the way. This is after his resurrection. He met them on the way. They didn't recognize who he was, But as he walked with them, they also didn't recognize that the Messiah had to suffer and die. So the whole crucifixion just blew their mind. It wrecked it. They lost hope. All their hopes and dreams just went down the drain, so to speak. And Jesus meets them. They don't recognize him. They don't recognize the meaning of what had happened. And Jesus begins to explain to them from the scriptures how this actually is all part of what the stories and the narrative of scripture had really actually predicted and said all along. And it says their hearts began to burn within them. Then they shared a meal and the breaking of bread. And when they did that, their eyes were opened and they recognized Jesus. And I shared last week that a meal with the breaking of bread, it was symbolic of communion. It was symbolic of fellowship. It was symbolic of community. It was symbolic of God's blessing on the community and the sharing of that blessing with everyone at the table. And this became so important for the early church because they recognized that it was within the family of God that Jesus is revealed. We talked a few weeks ago about how the gospel is not empty words. Amen. It is the power of God for salvation. The power of God for deliverance, the power of God for wholeness and healing to everyone who believes. But Paul says that if we do not live out the implications of the gospel, if we do not let the gospel become the power of God in us, then our proclamation of that gospel becomes empty words. And he used the communion table as an example, and he said, listen, if you just partake of the communion table and just make it a ritual, but do not actually have the substance of what it points to, then you'll be missing the power of God in your midst. Amen. Because you're just involved in a ritual. Jesus said that all men will know that we are his disciples by what? By our love for one another. And it is in the context of loving God, loving other people, making God's love known, three of our core values here, three of our part of how we kind of describe who we are, which is just for every church. It's in that context that eyes are open to see Jesus. I want to read from you a story or an account of the very, very beginning of the church. It's recorded in Acts chapter 2. And Peter had just preached to a crowd that had gathered, and many responded. And it says this, it says, so then, those who had received his word were baptized, and that day there were added about 3,000 souls. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, the gospel, and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Four simple things. They devoted themselves to the gospel, meaning they devoted themselves to preaching the gospel, but more importantly, understanding it and working it out in their own lives. They would take the implications of that gospel and begin to live it out. They did that. They fellowshipped. They broke bread together. And they prayed. Four things. Four things. Now look at what happens. Everyone kept feeling a sense of awe. And many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their possessions, their property and possessions, and were sharing them with all as anyone might have need. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. They did four things. that worked out the implication of the gospel in their life. They actually lived it out. The gospel is a proclamation of a truth. The truth that Jesus is the anointed and chosen one of God. He's already been seated at the right hand of God, given all authority on heaven and earth. That's the announcement of that truth. Well, that truth has a lot of implications. If it's true, you know it to be true, you believe it to be true, it changes everything about the way in which you live. So they did that. Then they got together, they fellowshipped, and they broke bread together. Amen. Meaning they shared communion, meaning they fellowshipped, they welcomed, they went from home to home, and they prayed. That's it. And what happens? Awe. Signs, wonders, miracles, and people being added every single day. Which is what Paul was getting at when he wrote to the Corinthian church and said, listen, if you're just playing church and you're just playing Christian, no wonder you're not seeing stuff happen. The gospel is not empty words. It's the power of God. So I want to take a look. In this series, we're going to look at love to the end. This morning, I just want to quickly talk about why your personal wholeness is the key to good relationships. Then we're going to look at the most important and least practiced part of communication. Then we're going to talk about, this is going to be a fun one. We're going to talk about the art of confrontation. Why confrontation is a vital characteristic of love and how to do it right. Yeah, you all laugh. I'm not going to tell you what order I'm doing because you're going to want to skip that one probably. No, I'm just kidding. We're going to talk about what creates unity and what creates division. And we're going to talk about encouragement and why it is one of the most crucial things if you're going to see good change. Amen. This morning, let's turn to Hebrews. This is going to be our scripture for this morning is from Hebrews. I know I've read quite a few. That was just setting the stage. And the book of Hebrews is an amazing book. And it's written largely to a Jewish audience. If you're going to understand the book of Hebrews, it's really good to kind of understand the Jewish culture and that context. But basically, it's an amazing book that really lays it out and proves from the scripture and all that who Jesus really is and why he had to do what he did and how it all actually makes sense and how all of the Jewish history was actually pointing to this person, Jesus, and his life and death and resurrection. And then we get to chapter 10. And he's explained all this, and now I want to read just a couple of verses, chapter 10, starting in verse 19. And he says, therefore, in other words, because of all I've just explained, here's what it means for you. Here's some of the implications. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God. Let me just stop. He just summarized the previous book, the previous part of this letter. He just summarized it. There's basically three points that I was making. Those three points are this. You have confidence. We have confidence to enter the holy place. The holy place was a room in the temple. For the Jewish people, the temple was the place where heaven and earth met and where God himself dwelled in his presence. And the holy place was that inner sanctum, if you will, where God's presence dwelt. And only the high priest could go in, and only once a year, to offer atonement for the entire nation. And the writer of Hebrews says, listen, through Jesus, that way has now been made. The once and for all atonement has been made, and now all are invited and welcome to come into the holy place. Wow, that's pretty heavy. That's pretty cool. That will change your life. So we have confidence into the holy place. So the next thing is we have a new and living way. Or I would put it this way. We have a new way of living. We have a new way of living. Because part of what Jesus did and part of what the gospel says is that all that God promised, and when you look at the scriptures, God's consistent promise from day one, and it hasn't changed one bit, is that he would redeem and restore this earth. That he would bring peace, he would bring justice, he would bring righteousness on the earth. In other words, he would fix what is wrong with this world. You know, and we all look, you know, it's very common to look forward to heaven as this place of paradise. But the promise is not just about going to heaven. The promise is that heaven comes to earth. That as it is in heaven, it will be done on earth. That's the promise. And the one and through whom this promise is going to be fulfilled is Jesus himself. In other words, God put Jesus in charge of the project to redeem and restore and bring heaven to earth. But here's the, and that's called the age to come. Okay, we have this hope, this age to come. But guess what? The gospel is that this is now breaking forth. That age to come is actually breaking forth into this age. It's breaking forth into this age. Which means one of the implications of the gospel is that we don't live our life according to the way the world says we should live. We don't live according to the ways of the world. We live according to the age to come. In other words, the way you're going to live then is the way you can start living today. It's a new way of living. It takes faith because the world says you have to live a certain way. The world says you have to look out for number one in order to succeed because no one's got your back but you. But that's not the kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of heaven says you can lay your life down because God's got your back. Now that takes faith to live like that today. But it's a new way of living. So we have confidence to enter the holy place. We have a new way to live. And then he says, and we have a great high priest over the house of God. Well, what does that mean? Well, the theme in scripture is always that the reason God started this whole project in the first place was that it would be a dwelling place for him. And the reason he created you was that you would be a dwelling place for him. And that humanity as a whole would be his image bearers, expressing who he is and a dwelling place for him. In other words, God's always wanted to have a community. God's always wanted to have a family. God's always wanted to have a bride. He's always wanted to have a temple who are a people. He's always wanted to whatever other term you want to use to describe that. It's about a community. So since we have this confidence to enter into his presence, since we have a whole new way to live, and since we're now part of God's family, he says, therefore, then he goes on and says, now let us do a few things. Number one, which is should be pretty obvious, let us draw near. Amen. I mean, if God has opened up the holy place, about the only thing that could possibly make sense is to beeline it right in. Draw near. I mean, if the God of the universe is saying, come on, come close to me. I'll tell you things you never knew. I'll be your refuge. I'll be your strength. Hello? We're talking about someone who's got such intense love, it can't be quenched. God is the happiest being in the universe, and there's nothing anyone can do to even dampen it one little bit. God doesn't have a bad day. He's the God of perpetual good days. I don't mean everything is good. I mean he's good. I don't mean he enjoys all that's happening. He doesn't. But he's enjoying himself in a sense. God enjoys the Son, and the Son enjoys the Father, and they both enjoy the Spirit. The Spirit enjoys both. They're having a good time. And he's saying, come near to me. Well, hello, but the only thing that makes sense is to run right in. So the next thing is hold fast. Let us hold fast our assurance, our confession of hope. In other words, he's saying, listen, if the age to come, our hope is in the age to come. But our hope is also that age to come is breaking forth into this current age. We need to hold fast to that hope. In other words, we have a new way to live and we need to live it. That's what he's saying. And then he says, and let us consider one another to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. And so the last thing he says is make a habit of coming together and gathering together for the purpose of provoking one to good deeds and to love and to encourage one another. We'll talk about those things a little bit later, but this morning I want to look at that gathering together and that consider. It says consider one another. Okay? Now what is your habit? You know, everybody has habits. A habit is just a routine. Everybody has routines. Things that you do regularly. Let me just ask, is part of your routine to develop authentic relationships? Is that part of your routine? Do you have a habit and a routine that allows you to be able to do that? That's the first thing. Now the writer, he says, now let us consider one another. Let us consider one another. Now that word consider means to understand. It means to perceive. It means to fix your eyes and your mind on. In other words, he's saying, know your brother or your sister. Know one another. Perceive one another. Fix your eyes and your mind on one another. Paul, and I want to read another scripture. I don't got a lot of scripture this morning because it's just everywhere. It's just so on my heart. It's burning on my heart. In his second letter to the Corinthians in chapter 7, before chapter 7, I'll read chapter 7 in a minute, one verse. But before that, he's writing to this church, and he writes to them about a number of different things. One of his main themes is that the gospel is about reconciliation. The gospel message is about reconciliation. First, we reconcile with God, and then we reconcile one to another. And he says, that we're actually ambassadors of reconciliation. And then he goes on and he says, we're the temple of God, meaning that the community of believers is the temple of God. And Paul makes a statement. He says to them, our hearts are wide open to you. And then he writes this to them. He says, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all defilement of flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. And I love this next statement he says. This is what he says. He says, make room for us in your hearts. We wronged no one. We corrupted no one. We took advantage of no one. I do not speak to condemn you. Now listen to this. For I have said before that you are in our hearts to die together and to live together. I don't know if you heard that. I have said before that you are in our hearts to die together and to live together. Come on, that's a powerful. At least the guys ought to get excited about that one. I mean, maybe that's not romantic talk. I'm going to go back to the Song of Songs for the ladies, but come on, for the guys, that's like band of brother kind of talk. We're going to die together and live together. Come on. But you got to make room, Paul says, make room in your hearts for us. You got to make room in your heart for relationship. And if you make room in your heart, you got to make room in your schedule. You know, it's part of what makes, you know, why I'm excited about Pray for One. And Pray for One is it's a simple prayer that we're praying as a congregation, corporately and individually, that God, would you just give us one person today to show your love to? And what that prayer does is it just makes room in your heart for new relationships. And one of the things I've discovered is that you cannot wait for community to happen to you. Amen. Can't do it. I'll give you some advice. If you want to have friends, you got to be a friend. Okay, you reap what you sow. I don't know too many people who, when they give themselves to others, when they befriend others, don't have friends around them. It's not to say that's our motivation. I'm just saying so often we want to have friends rather than be a friend. And the first thing here, in terms of healthy relationships, the writer says we have to consider others. You know, one of the things that sin does, and we see this happen with the very first instant recorded in the Bible in Genesis chapter 3, one of the things that sin does is it redefines our identity. And instead of our identity being rooted in our relationship with God, our identity becomes rooted in our own self-evaluation of ourselves. Okay? So sin redefines our identity. And what it does is instead of our identity being rooted in our relationship with God, our identity becomes rooted in our self-evaluation. And everybody has these nagging questions. Am I loved? Am I significant? What gives me value? How can I be happy? And then we end up relating to the world according to these questions, these unanswered questions, according to the self-evaluation of who we are. That's how we end up relating to the world. And we bring it into our relationships. We bring it into our relationships. And listen, if you can hear this, every one of our relationships gets tainted with this need for affirmation, with our need to feel loved, our need to feel respected, our need to feel important or valued. And even though we may be trying to love others, we have this kind of hidden flaw that causes us to approach relationships in a self-serving manner. And even though we want to give and we want to love, inevitably, there's this undercurrent within us that makes relationships about what I actually get out of it. How does this relationship benefit me, in other words? And we see it all the time. Inevitably, when we begin to feel like the relationship isn't serving our needs properly, what do? We begin to discard the relationship. You offended me, and now all of a sudden, I've got a wall. I no longer have room in my heart for you because you're not serving my need in this relationship. And it's why the gospel is so powerful. The gospel is the grace of God that restores our identity back to a relationship with God. Am I loved? Yes. God loves you with an unwavering love. That's who you are. I love that song, right? That's who you are. Am I significant? Yes, you're significant. You were created to bear his image. In other words, you were created to be an expression of who God is. How can I be happy? Drink deeply of your relationship with God. And you will find a satisfaction that cannot be found in anything else. And there's the countless testimony for thousands of years among those who have said, have learned what it is to be identified as a son or a daughter of God, and to drink deeply of that relationship. The universal testimony is that it is such satisfying, it is such healing, it is such wholeness. It changes everything about the way in which we live. Amen. And when you're full and in your whole on the inside, you relate to the world very differently. You're not relating to it out of your need for affirmation, to feel significant, because you've got all those things. You've already been affirmed. You've already loved. You're already secure in that with God. And now you relate to the world no longer about what you need from the world, but what you can give to the world. And the same is true for relationships. Healthy relationships are not based on what I need from this relationship. It doesn't start from a place of, I need you to be something to me in order for me to be okay. I don't need you to do or be something for me to be happy. Amen. And that's why I say healthy relationships start with your own wholeness. It radically changes the way in which we relate. Imagine what it would be like within a community if we lived like that. If we drew deeply from the Lord. Amen. Where our complete satisfaction was in Him. Where we were secure. We're not wondering, am I loved? Am I significant? Do I have value? We're not struggling over those things. You know what ends up happening is it's impossible to quench your love. It's impossible. No flood. No pain. Like it said in the Song of Songs, no pain. No persecution even. There is nothing that could come against you that would quench your love. How many would like that? All right. How do you get there? Okay. I'm going to give it to you. You ready? Number one, draw near to God. Amen. It may sound obvious and good. I hope it's obvious. But better is to actually do it. Draw near to God. Number two, hold fast your confession of hope. In other words, have faith. Pray. Receive grace. See, the hold fast your confession of hope, what are we hoping? Our hope is that there's a new way of living. Our hope is that God's kingdom is a reality. It's coming in the age to come, but for us today, it's actually breaking forth today, which means I can draw near to the throne of grace. This is not something that's dependent on you. This is not something that you produce within yourself. It's something that the grace of God produces. And the way is open. So you can draw near to God. And if you can draw near to God, if you are loved by God, if you are affirmed by God, if you are significant to God, if you have value in God's eyes, does that not mean He will not freely give you everything? It says, if He has not freely given you His Son, will He not freely give you all things? We can draw near because God says it's His grace. In other words, you don't earn it. You don't deserve it. You're not drawing near for grace because you've had a good week and you've been a good little boy or girl and you deserve some grace. No, you draw near because you need some grace. And God has said, listen, I'm okay. I don't need you to be something else in order for me to be okay. I'm okay. And guess what? We're okay. I've taken care of it. I have forgiven. So come, draw near and get grace. So draw near to God and then pray. I'm just telling you, I personally cannot think of an instance where I've asked God for grace and he has said no. I mean, I don't know what your experience is. I'm not aware of anywhere where God says he's just not going to answer that prayer. See, and you got to pray, but the Bible says you got to pray with faith. Because if you don't pray with faith, you're just confused and you're like, you're just going to get tossed by the waves. See, if you don't actually believe that the grace of God is available for you and that the grace of God is powerful and can change you in an instant, and I mean in an instant, okay? And I'm not saying there's not a place for counsel. There is a place. That's great and whatnot. But honestly, you just don't need 10 years of counseling for have the grace of God come and make a real change in you. You'd be surprised if you believe and are willing. Bam! When you pray, you draw near to God and you pray. And then the third thing I'm going to say is make it a habit to develop authentic relationships. It's not just going to happen. Okay, you're not gonna learn how to love by being a hermit. Okay, you develop authentic relationships, make it a habit. There's all kinds of ways you can do that. Okay, and personally, I mean, I love Sunday mornings. I think they're awesome. There's something very special about the corporate gathering. There's kind of like an energy and an excitement when we all come together. I mean, that was just so much more fun when everybody shows up. There's just something fun about that, right? It's fun when everybody, and by the way, please do not underestimate the value of your presence in a gathering. I would love to get that message across somehow, that your presence means something. It's not just filling a seat and has nothing to do with who has a platform or who doesn't. Your presence in a gathering means something. So as much as I love the Sunday celebrations, deeper relationships aren't always going to take place here. You need the smaller gatherings, whatever that looks like. I mean, we have life groups and small groups. That's one way, but there's all kinds of ways where you can develop authentic. The early church was described as day-to-day, house-to-house, breaking bread and fellowship and encouraging one another and praying for one another. And that just takes time and it takes a habit and it takes routine. All right? That's where I'm going to end this morning. So, love to the end. That's going to be our new series. Amen. And the first step is be whole. Be whole in Christ. Get your identity in him. And that is the foundation upon which everything else will begin to work. And we're going to go through a whole bunch of, I think, very practical things on healthy relationships, healthy church, what that looks like. But it all starts with this foundation that you're whole in Christ and your identity is firmly rooted and grounded in his love. And from that place, you can now develop authentic, real relationships. All right, amen. Thank you for coming this morning. Do want to remind you next week, invite a friend, and we also have our meet and greet. So if you are newer to River of Life, I just want to personally extend an invitation to you to join us after service next week for a short lunch, an opportunity to get to know you and meet you. All right.